we're in a war. And so I'm out here because this is part of fighting that war. You know, and been out here trying to fight all of my life, really. That's the only life a person really should have. If you're in a war, your whole life should be about the war. And so that's what I've been doing. And that's what I'm hearing. My cold beat me up now, but by the time I get here in the morning, I'm going to have fixed this. I'll fix this tonight. I know what to do.
Shout out to Wise Intelligence. That track was called Another Chance. Yo, we up out of town.
Some beautiful music.
It's off the hook. You ain't gonna hear this on what they call mainstream, but this is mainstream. This is not just radio, it's TV. So y'all can go back, share this show, tell everybody about the Sabir Bey Show, Instagram it out, tweet it out. We on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, you name it. Shout out to Jessica Abraham Hogan, who produces the show. She does all the graphics for the show. Man, and I gotta give a shout out to my host, Alberto, Sal, Christian Little, Hayes, DJ Hayes is not in the building. They will be coming back Tuesday on the show. Listen, man, I want to thank James.
We put on any celebration that has to do with our consciousness, any changes that we can make. We have, at one time we had a program every day. Right now we got four. We got West African Drums and Dance, the Mali Drums. We put out 100 people on the floor. That's on Saturdays. You know, you guys are here on Wednesdays. Saturday program we have at the park. But we have African Spiritual Consciousness, African Spiritual Practices on Thursday, meditation and so forth. We're involved with different groups, Asir Aset, Rogan, serious study of ourselves. So, and we're going to keep going.
But it's nice. I mean, LA is a nice spot. It has another whole rhythm. Sometimes it doesn't even seem like the U.S. when you come, you know, after you've been in the Midwest and you've been in the South. Come to LA, kind of like you move into another country. But it's a big city with a lot of people. And I'm just wondering what black folks is doing out here right now. So y'all going to have to hit me so I can drop some of that tomorrow. This thing about liberating black folks by any means necessary. When Malcolm made that statement, it confused a lot of black folks, because everybody reduced necessary, a word that meant the multiple and the multiplicity of things. We reduced it to the gun. Malcolm never said that. We reduced it to only one means. Malcolm never said that. Right after he made the statement, he said that he went into a definition of black nationalism. And he said, black nationalism means you must control the economic, politics, and culture in the communities where you live. Now, you can't talk about building a nation and you shopping at other people's stores that won't hire your son. Kind of saying, I don't care if they look like you. You know, we got to get real, you know. And it's hard, I know Morris probably been working hard to kind of put that national identity on the people who call themselves African Americans. But what we have to work with, if we can't get them to grab the label, let's get them to grab the identity. You understand? Then we can get the label on. You understand what I'm saying? And that becomes very important because, see, if you don't know you are a people or how you are a people, you can't organize yourself as a people. And so everybody from everywhere come from all over the world, sit on our butt, piss in our face, and do worse to us in the name of some brotherhood that nobody practices but us. That's some deep stuff. And it hurts because I'm figuring at 69, even if I do the healthy thing like most of the family do, I only got a good 20 years to go. I gotta worry about my grandkids and great grandkids going through the same stuff. And so I'm at war at the cemetery when I go into my recycling process, like you're going to do, like we've all done. But we're going to go into that a little bit. But I just wanted to get some stuff on the top so you can kind of know where I'm coming from. You know, when Malcolm X got assassinated, everybody ran. Today everybody was saying, oh, I was his bodyguard. Bodyguards supposed to have some bullets in there. Yeah. I tell you, the man's bodyguards, he got 19 bullets. You know, Harris passport.
I'd be ashamed to say that. You know, but there were people have service, and there were a few people who were with them up until that moment. Like Brother Earl Grant, who lives out here, Brother Earl was with him till that moment. There was a few others who had passed on. But most of these people, yada, 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 and they wasn't with them. Just like a lot of them yadding about Dr. King, they wasn't with them. You know, I did security for Dr. King, I'm kind of old. I walked with Kwame Ture, Rap Brown. We all worked together. I was security for Adam Powell. And when Malcolm got assassinated, everybody ran. At 21, I became the imam of the mosque. In those days, I was Haj Amin Shaheed. So you learn a lot being with people. And God protected me well because I was the best kept secret in the world. Let you know who the hell I am. And that's good. I had a chance to teach tens of thousands of young black people in a number of universities and across this country. I've actually been lecturing for over 50 years. That's a good time to be.
Every day, like when we were back 30, 40 years ago trying to get black studies in the school system, it wasn't the white folks that thought we were crazy. They knew what it meant. They were just trying to block us. It was the black folks thought we was crazy. If we could only have convinced the black folks that something, like Harriet said, something was wrong with them, we would have every school in our community teaching our history. So it was our own people who just couldn't see this thing. Why do you? And they always asked the question when we finally got black studies on the campuses and young people wanted to take that as a major. It was always the family asking, what are you going to do with it? Nobody ever asked the person who majored in Western civilization, what are you going to do with it? Or European history, what are you going to do with it? But when you said you were going to major in African history, African American history, they wondered, well, what are you going to do with it?
Now we have to start defining what our relationships are and what necessity has forced us into doing and stop allowing the lesser being to do that to us. So we're going to talk today about liberating blacks by any means necessary. So I'm going to use African, African-American blacks interchangeably. And because I'm invited out here by a bad Moorish brother, I'm going to add, I didn't put it, the Moorish label. But don't let me joke, I know where it comes from, I know where the label comes from. And Moors preceded African as an identity for our people. Correct. So Bay and them will give you that history at some time, but I just want them to know, I'm on it. You know what I'm saying? So we're going to talk about one of the things, African spirituality as the overgirding, as the arching thing, but liberating blacks by any means necessary as the assignment. And let's pray this thing works, because I was fooling with it. Y'all saw me fooling with it a while ago. Oh man, that's the black family. You know, I don't know who they are. I took them off the computer, but they're symbolic enough. The history of white America, the history of white Europe have been about destroying what you see out there. Destroying the black family. If you go back as far as you can go in history, they're cutting out our testicles. They're raping our women. They're killing off the men. Even go back to the Bible. No disrespect to the Hebrew Israelites, but coming out in the book of Exodus, you'll say, kill all the women that have been with men and take the virgins unto yourself as wives. And so, genocide against the black family has always been the order of the day. And you gotta understand that when these things we read in these books, let's read well. Read well. There's hardly a book written where there isn't something worth using for your betterment. But be careful to leave the things that is of no use to you right where you find them. And take those things that will be good for you and carry yourself forward. So when we say African, and the word African, that ka, you know, from Africa, Afri was some Moorish people that lived in an area called Tunisia, Algeria, just about that area. They had a term for their clans, Afri, the area that became Carthage, where the Romans settled. They call themselves Afri. The word probably simply means living beings or human beings. That's all they were saying. When the whites came, the Romans, and they invaded that area, and they saw the Afri, so Car is their acronym for land, so they went to Afri land.
They were at the Afri land where the Moors lived. Of course, they didn't use the word Moors, that's the English rendition, plus the word Moorish. Moorish. They went to Afri land where the Moorish lived, the blacks lived.
We're being programmed every day, TV, newspapers, radios, music, with his knowledge arrangement. He has arranged knowledge in a way, even when you think you're drinking something good for you, it ain't good for you. You know, so we have to find out how we're gonna arrange this knowledge. You know, what's good and what's bad. You know what I'm saying? We have to determine that. Right now, many times, even when we're trying to be conscious, we still reckoning good and bad based on his ethical, moral interpretation of what's good and what's bad. What is my relationship to a bumblebee? You know what I'm saying? What is my relationship to a blade of grass? What is my relationship to the wind? And tomorrow I'm going to go in some of that in terms of traditional African religion, why they have these symbols that represent forces of nature. You talk about Yemoja in the Yoruba, you're talking about the big waters. You're talking about Olokun, you're talking about the depth of the waters. You're talking about Oya, you're talking about the wind. You're talking about Shango, you're talking about the thunderbolt and the lightning, but you're talking about forces of energy. So all of the things that we call deities or rishis or busun, loas, represented forces in nature. But not just forces in nature external to us, it also represents forces of nature internal to us. And how do you make the reckoning of the relationship between what's in nature and what's in you? Because we are composite of all of nature. Whatever nature is, we that too.
And so we talked, this one a little quickly, at a little graph that I picked up off the line. It's called Racial Disparity Between the U.S. and the Incarcerated Population. So we see that white folks in the population is close to 65%. But in incarceration, they're only about 30%. Black folks, who's less than 25%, in incarceration, we're nearly 50%. And so the criminalization of the black race, we need to take very seriously. And there's a good book on the subject. And it's called The Criminalization of a Race by a sister who's an ancestor named Shashi McIntyre. So this book should be a must-got. This is her dissertation, but if anybody knows Shashi, she worked with Dr. Jeffries, Dr. Clark, Dr. Ben. She was one of the baddest scholars out here. And Dr. McIntyre was Native American and African from East Coast America, who never let anybody push against her to what we understand clearly to be the Moorish American tradition and her African tradition. And she was one of the most fantastic of teachers. There's another good book on the subject that says, Why Are So Many Black Men in Prison? It's worth studying to understand how this war is being fought against us. If the war system's coming, the war is against the youth. No, the war is against the race. The youth just happened to be the target on that occasion. But the youth is not separate from this race. Okay, the war is against the race. And they figure if we can knock out one leg, we can cripple the whole body. So we have to understand that clearly. The first school is in the home. We should make sure we do it in our home. That means our history should be taught in our home. And above all the things, make sure that no child walk out of your home without having a math foundation undergirding whatever else they're learning. Race of defendants approved for federal death penalty prosecution. We saw who commit the crimes, but yet 50% of the people on death row are black folks. 25% of the crime committers, white folks, are there. So, you know, I study the Yoruba history a lot, and the things I'm talking about traditional religion is going to be from the Yoruba perspective. There's no such thing as a Yoruba religion, though. There's a Yoruba people that live in Nigeria. They simply practice an African spiritual system. But we misnomer call the African spiritual system Yoruba religion, but that's really a misnomer. Okay, and anybody want to disagree with me? I'm like, we can discuss it. But the Yoruba is the people. They practice the same religion all other Africans practice. And that's the religion of the laws of nature. The religion of the laws of the cosmos. The religion of our relationship to the laws of nature and the cosmos. And their relationship to us.
That thing that Jesus went to and represent should be the experience of every man coming into consciousness. when you come into consciousness, you become what they call God. But not what people, what people are calling consciousness today is you have a certain amount of information, you read two books, you watch a video, and then they said, I'm the conscious community, and most of them are as dead as someone in the cemetery. That's not the conscious community. This is the conscious community right here. Conscious community is not very big. It's a very small group of people trying to wake up the other people so that this conscious community could expand. But the enemy will play a trick on you. It'll make you think you're awake when you're fast asleep. And I think, I remember hearing a song a brother in the Bahamas sang, and it was called Being Wide Awake in a Dream. And a lot of us are wide awake in a dream, but we're really still asleep, but we think and we're dreaming that we're awake. And we're trying to convince people that we are awake when we're really sleeping. Our ancestors did not leave us empty-handed. All the information we need, they've left it for us. They've left it for us in the form of our traditional system, the Dogon, the Akan, the Kemeting system that we see all over the Nile Valley. They've left the wisdom for us. We have to study that wisdom. When we lived in the South, those root women and those root men who the community were rejecting, they were our herbalists and our healers who kept the wisdom with us even though we were over here. They were using the church because that's all they had, but they were the village chiefs and they maintained the system. Today, something else has happened with the black church. But if you go back into the 1800s, the turn of the century, you were basically talking about the African village and the African chief, and you were talking about extended families and how it gets structured and how it get organized as a clan with their totems. But we have to first know, what of Africa have we kept? And you're not gonna know that until you start studying what Africa is.
But the white man have turned it into these other perversions and got you worshiping up him as the image of God. He's actually made God in his image. And then got you worship up his image. But if you just took the 12 tribes of the Old Testament and look up the etymology of the name of each tribe, took the 12 the disciples of Christ and ethnologically studied them, you're talking about qualities and attributes to be developed in the human personality that you can find as forces in nature already. That's what it's about. Y'all understand me? Did y'all understand that? Y'all something like, did y'all really get it? And for the Muslim brothers, they call it the 99 pearls of faith. But most people with religion, they're trying to incarcerate you. They're not trying to liberate you. All right? So you got to get with that. I want to be free to be God. I don't want to be imprisoned by God. And this is one of our beautiful brothers, Todd G. Woodson. He said, if a race has no history, if it has no worthwhile tradition, it becomes a negligible factor in the thought of the world, and it stands in danger of being exterminated. And aren't we there? If you don't think we are, just look at what happened in Liberia, Sierra Leone, and Guinea over the last year with the Ebola thing. Dr. Clayton Nobles, one of our great scholars from up in Oakland, who just came out with a new book. Y'all gotta get it. It's called The Island of Mimes. The Island of Mimi. I'll tell you what Mimi is later. A true study of history allows one to tie bits and pieces of their scattered historical information together. This would allow us to develop foresight, create goals for our future, insight, know our present condition, hindsight, learn from our past.
Everybody here has always been here. There's never been a time in time when the spirit that occupies these bodies wasn't in existence. What Wade is calling the Mimes is the memory of the spirit. When you remember when you were here the last time, that's when you're there. That's when they call you an Orisha. That's when they call you a God. Because you remember that I always was. Freedom is when you arrive and you know that you're a God having a human experience call you. And it's so simple to understand. If there's something called God, omnipotent, omnipresent, omnipotent, and supreme, it means nothing else can occupy any space anywhere else except it. It is the only thing that is. So then what is all the rest of us? We're just expression of aspect of that, you know? But you have to become conscious of that, that if I'm an expression of an aspect of the thing we call the divine, what aspect of it am I? That's what the search detail goes into. That's when people say, I'm going to tell you who your Loa is, or I'm going to tell you who your Orisha is, or I'm going to tell you who your Obusum is, or I'm going to tell you who your Netta is. Yes, those forces, all of us have got all the forces in us. Every force in any part of nature or the cosmos is in all of us. But there's one usually more dominant than all others. And sometimes if you're strong and you're healthy and you're studying and you're raising your consciousness and you're eating well and you're doing exercise and you living out that, then you can raise up more than one of those forces in you. And then you become a force yourself. In a way people may not understand it. They just know this person can do this, they can do that, because you've brought those forces alive and you've cultivated them. You know them and you cultivate them. But you have to realize that such a phenomena exists. The way the thoughts get arranged in your mind, is there such a thing? Some people make us believe that there's a man called God. I mean, it's the most foolish thing. When I was a child, it sounded like a real thing. Mm-hmm. But when you get knowledge, you realize that's the most foolish idea anybody can come up with. And why would anybody believe that? Well, people believe it because they've been made afraid of this thing called death.
And so that means you must have knowledge. What does that, I'm big on the definition thing, that's a Malcolm text. Don't get bored by the definition thing. Knowledge is the state of knowing, understanding. To know is to apprehend with the conscious mind, to be acquainted with by experience, to recognize, to have acquired skill in, to be informed about, to be in possession of facts about, having understanding or awareness of something. It's important to know what knowledge is and what knowing is, because a lot of time I'm talking to people and they start talking about knowledge and philosophy and they don't have a clue what knowledge is. And so if stuff isn't organized appropriately, it won't inform you appropriately. So you must organize your knowledge. And out of having knowledge, you develop this concept called prudence. It's foresight leading a person to avoid error or danger. The ability to know what is useful and what is not. That leads to intelligence. The ability to perceive logical relationships and use one's knowledge to solve problems and respond appropriately to novel situations. That leads to this thing. We hear people talking about, I'm in the conscious community, but damn, a lot of what I see saying the conscious community is conscious, I'm running the other way. That's not conscious. Consciousness is to be immediately aware of, while mentally recognizing, to some degree and extent, one's own inner feeling and thought, or their objective reference. So before you can even deal with anything outside of you, when you're talking about consciousness, you have to recognize what we call intuitive knowledge, which is inside of you. Consciousness is to be mentally alert, well aware of some object, impression, or truth. Consciousness, the power of self-knowledge, internal perception. Consciousness is a product of direct and convincing knowledge, whether of external or internal objects. That leads to someone becoming wise. Wise is having the ability to make a right decision or judgment by applying intelligent thought to a wide range of experience and knowledge with prudence. Wisdom and the quality of being wise. Intelligence drawing on experience and governed by prudence. That prudence is there again. A store of knowledge, a correct application of knowledge. That's the key to wisdom. A correct application of knowledge, the ability to convert knowledge into teaching. Philosophy, the love or pursuit of wisdom. The search of basic principles, systematic principles of any subject or branch of knowledge. Cycle. I put cycle in here because we've been in this cycle. And we haven't been able to get out of the cycle because we've been denying knowledge of ourselves. And many leaders have come to us, male and female, over these centuries, both here and on the continent, in the Caribbean, in the Pacific Islands, trying to get us out of the cycle by having us reference our ancestors, and we rejected them for the pleasant, the stimulation that wanting to be like the devil affords you. It actually feels good.
Yes.
You know, think of devilish stuff. Y'all know when you think of doing devilish, that stuff does feel good, but it's almost always wrong. You know, so we have to, I'm not going into detail, but you know what I'm talking about on all the levels. So, cycle, something we have to begin to understand so we can know how to break cycles, is a series of recurring events or phenomena, i.e. the cycle of the seasons, a period of time occupied by a set of events which will go on recurring in similar periods of time, i.e. 5 days, 5 months, 5 years, unless we do something to stop it. By changing course, and that means by getting a new body of knowledge in our consciousness.
You can get a dynamic female that can do dynamic change. You get a dynamic male. But if you get a male and female that is clear on who they really are and clear on why they've come together, I think some people call this concept soulmate. There's some other terms for it, where you recognize that spirit, or you can call it that angel, that you did work with 10,000 years ago. 5,000 years ago, you recognize that spirit, and y'all recognize what your mission is in this location at this time, and you go about your mission. That's another programming of the human consciousness. How are we going to be programmed? Who's going to program us? We're going to keep being programmed by the European intellect. Today I was using the term Europeans in blackface, and a lot of times, even when we want to do even what we call the blackest thing, we don't understand that the information that form how we make the decisions didn't come from us at all. And unless we change that information that forms the consciousness, it doesn't matter what the intent is, you will never reach your goal.
And so, Kwaku Ture told us we must organize, organize, organize. And I love organization. You know what? It's the most significant thing we need to do, and the definition is one sentence. A number of individuals systematically united for some end or work. A number of individuals systematically united for some end or work. That is organization. And that's part of what we have been missing. How do we systematically unite for some end or work when we think that we are all so different? Not a single person in this room look alike. Not a single one of us weigh the same thing, shape in the same way. And yet each of us is constructed as the divinity that constructed all of us. Every one of us looks like the divine. Every one of us looks like the divine. But we've allowed somebody to come and say only a select group looks like the divine. Only a select shape or height or size. And if you don't fit within those categories, then you are something outside of the perimeter of the divinities. Love and expression. Every one of us in here is an exact duplicate of the divine. That's African philosophy. And if you understand and grasp that, organizing ourselves will become much easier to do. We have brothers who say, I'm Muslim. Brothers who say, I'm Yoruba. Brothers who say, I'm Moorish. Brothers who say, I'm Christian. Brothers who say, I'm Hebrew Israelite. Brothers who say, I'm atheist. Brothers say, I don't give a damn. But guess what? Ain't nothing different about none of them, except they are all trying to walk a different path towards the same ball of light. Okay. That's all it is.
It is a tool of spirituality. In order to teach something, you must have tools. People say when they think of culture, you may think of dancing as culture. Dancing is not culture. Music is culture. Music is not culture. Theater is culture. Theater is not culture. Those are tools of culture. What is culture? Culture is your understanding of the natural laws. How do you then teach those things to yourself? Then you need tools. Dancing is one of the tools. Music is one of the tools. Drama is one of the tools. But what are you trying to teach? You're trying to teach the way of life, of nature and the cosmos, how they work. Sister mentioned Ma'at. You got people really walking around thinking Ma'at is a woman. Ma'at is that force in nature that demands harmony and balance. It doesn't matter whether you know the name, recognize it or not, harmony and balance is going to struggle to be in the universe. You may be out of balance, but the universe is not out of balance, and the universe will punish you for being out of balance. But the universe is not going out of balance. Ma'at is constant. It's always. And so what we do in trying to recognize Ma'at in its universal constancy, we try to recreate it in ourselves so that then we can be like the universe and be like nature.
You're talking about economic politics and culture. Those three things must work together. And you can't have economic politics and culture without spirituality, because spirituality is the centerpiece of your culture. Then religion is the tool that spirituality creates to teach itself to itself. Politics is the management system of your economic system, your sociology. It creates the rules and the regulations that govern the distribution of your wealth. The six building blocks of any nation, individual, family, ethnic, clan, culture, neighborhood, community, nation, state. A people in a district, this is what a neighborhood is now, people in a district, town or city, or an area planned as a unit with its own shop, service, and amenities, persons or things situated near or relatively near one another. Now that's a neighborhood. But a community is a body of people or neighborhoods living near to one another and in social relations. It's a body of people with their faith, profession, or way of life in common, and is in common ownership of the business and the services where they live. If you're not in common ownership of the businesses and the service where you live, you're not in a community. You're in a neighborhood in somebody else's community. And we need to get that down so we can start building communities. Amen. That if you can build communities, they unite to create nations. It doesn't matter where you are in the world, you can build a nation. Okay? You can build a nation. But you first must build a family. Then you must build neighborhoods with those families. Then you must build communities. And then the community will allow you to build a nation.
You're already free. You're just trying to gain the information on how to enhance your freedom. But the minute you decided that you wanted to be free, you were free. Now you're trying to, you know, it's like being in a prison. We decided, look, we don't want to be in here. The minute you start to plot that breakout, you're free, whether you ever get out there or not. The minute you decide, I'm breaking up out of here, this is not where I want to be, this is not my life, this is not how I am, I'm going to get free of this. You're already free when you make that decision. Everything else is just the process.
Ogun is transformation. So once you decide you need to change, and then that decision of the need to change marries change in process, then change in process marries transformation, and then you move your spirit to a higher level. And that is called Ogun. Because if you want to make iron, you take a piece of rock, or dirty rock out the ground, you throw it in the fire, you put the heat to it, fire it up, and it turns to steel. Transformation. That's the end of my lecture. Thank you all.
So I'm out here with Sabir and Sister Karen trying to, they think I've come to teach, but I've come to learn. You know, I told my first trip to LA, they threw me in jail.
Ain't it funky? Ain't it funky? Ain't it funky? Ain't it funky? God.
We're going to, we don't have a choice. It's the law of nature. What goes around comes around. It's just, it's taking a long time. And as long as it takes, we will suffer until we decide we're going there. Mm-hmm. Until we decide we're going there.
What's going on, everybody? It's your man, Sabir Bey. I'm here with my man, Amadeuz Christ. He got a new documentary coming out called Out of Darkness, man. You gotta see it, gotta check it out. I co-sign this. Peace.